back to another drawing video. It's been a few days since the last video, which I was drawing page one, and things have really sort of ramped up. It's page three. I finished this the other night, and I was quite happy with it until I looked at this panel. I'm just going to bring the camera in just so you can see. Look at that, camera moves and everything. That's the panel design. And essentially he's slumped over, his whole world has come crashing down, and he's supposed to be offering a shoulder to cry on, but it doesn't look like that. It looks like he's been shot and he's cradling him in his arms as he's dying. So I want to redraw this panel and then we'll make a start on page four. I've earmarked about half hour for this, so let's get drawing. But first up, I want to take care of this. So I'm just going to... do that. Just going to do this. Here's an interesting thing I found, or I've discovered recently. I've rediscovered the joy of erasing artwork. You can do it to get rid of it. You can also knock back your pencils so that they're less strong. Yeah, so effectively you can work on top of the pencil you've already drawn. But let's go with this one again. I can faintly you might be able to see, but I can still faintly see the pose, the original drawing. So I'm going to go with that as my original. There's our head. This is the brow line there, and then obviously you've got the nose line and mouth and chin and stuff like that. So there, probably something like that. This line is this part. If you look at the, if you look at the side of your face, right, you've got this contour. This part's really useful because if you were to have it as a flat plane, it describes this part of the eye socket and that part of the cheek. So I think it's, I always think it's really useful to define that. And what you end up with is a character that looks a bit like Rum Space Knight. Right, let me show you. Fresh bit of paper. So I'm gonna draw fairly big. So I start off by just defining a sort of a really loosey goosey rectangle, a box that I put up. Yeah, it's got a neck on it already, so yeah. So center line down the middle. It's fairly straightforward, right? That's that bit we're looking at. Then we've got that line there, that line. Then we're going to put that line in, and then that line. So it's something like that, something like that. That's also where you want your nose to sort of start, somewhere about there, maybe. You know, depending on the proportions. Chisel it in a little bit there. If you imagine this is the side, it's like a rectangle, it's like a square. I want this line down here, is this will form that, for want of a better word. So this is back of the head sort of stuff here, sort of down here, across, probably something like that. It's our draw line. And carve this around a little bit so it's not quite so boxy. This is where our nose is going to be, so I'll define that. Put that. Something like that. I mean, I'm just drawing the forms in. Use the razor, not that bit backed. So I want that. That one there, just about maybe. is your eyebrow ridge, which is more defined on sort of male characters, sort of that brow. Mouth goes sort of equidistant, yeah, like that. Sort of take a line down, something like that. It's very flat at the moment. Actually, the line needs to deform around, so actually, you probably want to do that. And then you've got your ears sort of going down the side, something like that. So you've got an ear somewhere about there. So the temporal ridge, that bit. There. So that's a very rough sort of head. But this is roughly my way of constructing heads for this sort of thing. So there. something interesting or not. So yeah, if you're interested in this channel and you find it fun or informative or light-hearted or something, give us a follow, like, share, subscribe, comment, all of that good stuff, and we'll just carry on. Things being what they are, probably only end up getting this first panel done. That's this line, the centre line going all over the top of the head and around. I just find that really useful. Temporal ridge, there. It's got a hat on, goes around there. It's got a little bit there. here's the one shoulder, here's the other shoulder. You're not going to see it, but what we're going to see is we're going to put his hand up here. So, in the original page, he speaks first, which is always a kind of a broken card, but it worked better with the framing. So might be a very quick drawing. So I suppose we could talk about the state of the comic book industry, maybe, and my run-in with Tom Taylor this morning, which is interesting. It's kind of a bit of a whole nothing burger. Basically, some reports came out in Publisher Weekly saying that 2019 was a bumper, super great, mega wicked, wonderful year for comic book industry. I think words were like, figures like $1.2 billion were floated around, and I just pointed out that if the industry is that good, if everything's that hunky-dory, why is Jim Lee, or why was Jim Lee auctioning off artwork to keep comic book stores going? And I got a snooty sort of passive-aggressive reply from Tom, and I sort of chased it up and asked, I think, a fairly intelligent, well, I hope it's a fairly intelligent quote follow-up answer. I never can tell. And so I've got a feeling that once this video is finished, I want everyone to take a second, just have a minute's mourning, because it must be terrible to be Tom Taylor. I could never understand or envision going through my life responding to general comments as a kind of a gotcha, how they did this. I was like, okay, whatever, the industry's safe then, everything's cool, right? I mean, you know, everything's great. I just, you know, not 3 weeks ago people were being having the pencils up and all that business. Or, and if it's that good, why are so many people putting like GoFundMes for medical expenses and things like this? But it must be good, because it's $1.2 billion, and right, you know, so. I mean, it must be good. I can't wait to see new Warriors. I'm sure that's going to be an absolute rip-roarer when that comes across, when it comes out, because I mean, I for one would be very interested to see how the whole concept of internet gas actually works. But surprisingly, they're very quiet about that now. But on the plus side, I did pick up a couple of small press books this week. I got the first two issues of Peter Dorey's Stan and Jack, which is sort of a slightly satirical look at some of the early comic book creators. I'm getting pucks now, is there? And It's quite fun actually. I've got two books for £8. That's £3 books with £2 postage. So yeah, I'm looking forward to issue 3 of that one. I think it's going to be really good. So yeah, that's great. And I might I don't know about reviews. The Wilderness Dog does reviews, but I mean, there's bits in it I think look great, and I want to say, hey, I really dig this bit, you know. Oh, it's really hard to draw his nose. Damn it, Dave, why did you pick? I'm gonna have to really build this a little bit. So yeah, I've a fairly low opinion of modern comic book creators, or at least how they act on the social medias. If everything is just a gotcha and they're just looking for, you know, likes and all that business, and you can keep all that. But I think the industry has problems. I think publishing articles like that is saying that, you know, last year we made $121 billion. That was great. That was last year. Why publish it now? What good does that do? You're not. There's no real benefit from that. So, much more interesting to say. It would be much more interesting to say, yeah, the industry has these problems, and here's how we're going to fix these problems, X, Y, and Z. And they could be whatever you want. Take your pick. Financial mismanagement, weird contractual stuff, incessant number ones, bad crossovers, poor behaviour from professionals, you know, and all of that implies just bad interaction with fans, down to the whole sort of Me Too / Time's Up sort of things that some of these creators are having at the moment. But what do I know? I don't know anything really. I'm just a guy with a camera, a pencil, and a dream. Speaking of guys with pencils, I caught CB Smallwood's new stream the other night. He was using Prism Labs streaming software, and that would actually look pretty good. It was quite an interesting stream, and he was doing some fan art for something called Trial by Fire, which looked fascinating. It's not too bad. Let's change. Horizon line is wrong. Well, I want to drop it a little bit. Put some trees. Put some happy little trees in. Keep that tree. So, what does he say? Probably have to do something like that, split it into two. Do that, maybe. It's a bit better. At the moment, it looks like it's looking at the top of his head, so we'll just change the position of the eye lines. Relatively happy with that. Right. I have got about 10 minutes left, if that, to make a start. On page 4. Alright, so let's have a look at this. We probably won't get a lot of drawing done for this because it's mainly a case of, as I've mentioned before, the assets need to be sort of moved around in the composition on this page. So we'll move that to there. Oops. If you can hear the clattering in the background, that's someone cooking downstairs. That's someone being the illustrious and wonderful Mrs. Hingley. Two panels should be good, and that we'll move this one across, and I'll move that asset across. And actually, that hand's too big for that, so let's make a start. Boy, just pulling in, hinting at the corners. Nettle's hand's far too big. I don't know, I didn't notice it before. That's okay. Whatever. This is the palm, so that's where the palm is going to go. Out to somewhere about there, and then 1, 2, 3, 4. So this hand comes around like that. You've got sort of this sort of an S going on. I think that'd be quite nice. Right. While I'm waiting for that, what I'll do next is I want to minimise the amount of white box work for this. I'll just start on this. Ah, yes, because we're doing a no bleed. Not a problem. Because the bleed is actually off there somewhere. Ah, screw it, we'll just not put the bleed in. It'll be fine. We'll just go there.
We can have that overlap now, that's no problem.
If you heard that, that's my little girl in the background. Obviously, she's watching something on TV that made her scared a little bit. Something like that. Not that frost, I just want. So for this is Oberon, and I base him a bit on like I forget his name on Instagram. On Instagram it's Doodle Dad, and his name's Gary, and heartwarming story of a devoted dad who unfortunately lost his wife due to sepsis and kept a diary of his doodles to sort of document his grief, I suppose. He's got two kids, and they're just fascinating group. Bunch of characters. They're really all great. They just did a series of lockdown videos where they were made like short films. I think the daughter's 14 or something. The son's like 10 or 11 or something, and they sort of did these spoof films, and it was spoofing all sorts of things from, you know, Star Wars, but they did one where it was a bit of Shakespeare, and it was, I believe, maybe it says Midsummer Night's Dream again. It's very popular. And he had this sort of costume for, I think he was being painted, I think he was playing Oberon in that one. And he had a sort of, I mean, he's got a beard anyway, and, you know. So especially this shot, this one here, I was really channeling him for that. So, let's look at the clock. We've done half an hour. It's a bit. Bit of a bust, but actually, not too bad because. What's that give us? That gives us just this one. Now, this guy, especially this pose, he's sort of going, yeah, they'll take care of themselves. Yeah, they're fine. It's all good. I'll start tomorrow. It's alright. I was really sort of looking at character called Grumio from a TV show called Plebs. And it's a recent comedy. And it's set in sort of ancient Rome. And Grumio is like the slave of a character called Marcus. It sounds impressive, but Marcus has got a really crap job as a an office worker. He lives with his flatmate, so he has a flatmate but also a slave, go figure, who is called, it was called Stylex. And Stylex essentially was a photocopier. All he would do was just copy images. And all the episodes were basically them getting into various scrapes and Grumio constantly getting them into trouble and getting them out of trouble, depending on whatever the plot needed. But he's very northern. He's all a little bit laid back. Mancunian is China. Mancunian is Manchester. That'd be a heck of a remake for the Manchurian Candidate, wouldn't it? Someone rocks up as Liam Gallagher. Can you tell he's been brainwashed? Ah, can. Actually, that's actually quite funny. Yeah, so you can tell that this is a non-stop cavalcade of fun and frivolity. And I thought it was really funny when I initially drew this to put Nettle in a shirt and tie right at the end. And in the original version of this, the suit is a sort of brown suit with a red tie, and the colours sort of echo his work clothes when he's painting toadstools. That was intentional. That was art design. Yeah. There's something about just get your pencils. Have to put that there. So I'm very certainly rearranging the fingers at this point. Just sort of work within our edge there. Yeah, nothing past there. It's tight, tight. I want the suit to be sort of beaten up looking as well. I think we'll call it there for now. Doesn't look like a lot, but actually that's four of the five panels sort of worked out. We need to sort of tighten this up, which I'll probably do tonight. And it's not a bad start. Into his beard. There. Mustache there. Yeah. It's okay. So we've got lots done. Calling it there. We'll probably look at this again tomorrow or another day. We'll even look at it tonight. So yeah, that's another video. Hope you found it interesting, hope you found it fun. And we'll see you in the next one. All right. Bye now.
Thanks for watching. Hit the subscribe button. Make sure you're still subscribed. And lock the bell for notifications. Okay. Bye bye now.